absence of any points of accuracy, I think it would be proceed.
Agreed.
Agreed. Changes are needed in terms of our culture, in terms of the processes we operate by, and also our structure. So what this paper does is present a set of proposals around one element of the new operating model, which is around the structure. I think it's important also that the structure proposals are designed to enable us to deliver our key priorities, and to do that at pace, because we have to make a range of changes in order to meet our budgetary targets, and we need to do them quickly. And the two things that we need, the three things that we need to focus on as an organisation over the next 3 years, 4 years, is the delivery of the 20 pledges, is the delivery of the transformation programme, and is to deliver on its budget. And the structure reflects, the structure proposal reflects, in my view, the best way of delivering those three things. There are four elements to the new structure. The first is a strategic hook. The strategic hook brings together all the capacity we have across the council to lead the delivery of the Wirral plan, the 20 pledges, the 17 support and strategies that have been agreed. The staff within it will work closely with our partners, with elected members of the Cllr Ann region, in order to deliver those pledges. And that's the primary focus of the strategic work. Business services. here the focus is to provide the necessary support to enable us to deliver the pledges and new delivery arrangements. I think we need to be more commercial as an organisation, more business-like, and we want the business services function to be able to drive that change in the way we operate with smoother processes. I think assets and digital will be key drivers for us in the future in terms of doing things differently. And this structure provides a clarity of leadership around those areas. But also we need to raise our game in terms of how we support commissioning. We need to not just focus on procurement, we need to also make sure we have relationships with our providers. We need to make sure that we can quality assure the services that we pay for. And therefore part of the proposals is to set up a new commissioning support unit within the business services function. The third area is around delivery. And this is both the day-to-day management of our services. And in ensuring that they are high quality, they're affordable, we meet our budgetary targets, and so on. But also we need this function to be a bit more commercial in its operation, and think about income, a bit more business-like. And we also need to look at new ways of delivering these services. We're currently involved in the process of reviewing all these services over the next 3 years. And out of that will probably come new ways of delivering. We already have examples of this where we integrate our services, for example, the Mental Health Trust, and we've set up two new delivery vehicles that are essential in the regions. So that's the type of thing we'll be looking at. And this particular part of the structure will focus on those areas. And then the final part of the structure is around transformation. We have a significant transformation agenda, and we need a transformation office that's able to help us deliver that agenda. And what I'm proposing is the appointment of a director of transformation to help that happen, because I would prefer to do more of this work within the council rather than engaging. I'll stop there and hand over to Chris, who will talk more about the detailed recommendations.
Okay, Chris.
Thank you, Chair. Okay, and I'll now take through the report and the appendices to outline the details of the proposals. And I suggest that if it's through the Chair, that we do that in two stages. Firstly, to look at the structure, the roles, and the impact on roles and individuals, and then to deal separately with the recruitment process. So the recruitment process is part of the proposal, but is once we've been able to look at the details of the structure. So obviously Eric, the Chief Executive, has introduced the background and the rationale for the change. The structure is a vehicle to deliver that new operating model and a vehicle to deliver the requirements. So we start really on page 10, at paragraph 5.19, where we look at the principles of the new structure, which are largely around ensuring that we've got the skills and capacity to deliver our objectives, and that we remodel what we have with some additional short-term capacity. And we then move on to, in paragraph 5.2 onwards, the proposed new structure. And there are three appendices to go through in terms of looking at the new structure and what it means. So if I start with Appendix 4, Appendix 4 is reminding the committee of the last chief officer structure that was agreed in 2012. And so the proposal is looking at the differences between that proposal, that structure, and the structure now. So the proposed structure, reflecting what the chief executive has outlined, is shown as Appendix 5. And from the chief executive, there are three key senior leads, reporting and managing services, the Executive Director for Strategy, the Director of Business Services, and the Managing Director for Delivery, with the Transformation Director reporting directly to the Chief Executive to lead and drive a transformation programme across across the council to make that happen. Within that, when you look at it, what you can see is the other chief officer roles. And for clarity, where you can see a box that highlights a title, a job title, it's because it's a chief officer role on which you're making a decision tonight. Where there is a box that reflects a function, such as if you look at the Executive Director of Strategy and Strategic Hub, there are three boxes, intelligence, strategy and communication. They are functions, but they are led by senior managers, and senior managers are not part of the remit of Employment Appointments Committee, whose remit is chief officer roles. But for completeness and to understand the structure, we've included them by way of functions, but not by way of job titles. I think that's just helpful by way of explanation. What that shows immediately as well is the proposals around slotting in an assignment to those new posts within the structure. That's Appendix 5. Appendix 6 then goes on to show the structure of the service delivery, reporting into the management director of delivery, and the post in that area, and where the different functions will sit alongside those posts, reporting to those posts. So, moving on to look at the alignment of posts within the structure. The alignment is based on the principles within the restructure policy, and the alignment is shown and the rationale on page 11 at 5.3. And it talks through that where there is no direct change to role or grade, there is simple slotting. Where there is a new or change roles where duties are similar, it's duties to similar role, and it's a suitable alternative because the substantive role will be deleted. It's a slotting subject to Appointments Committee approval. Where there's a newly created role and the proposal funded by deletion of a senior management post, it's internal recruitment process by ENA appointments panel, and a new post that is a vacancy is an internal or external recruitment through ENA committee. Summary of the aligned roles and new structure shown at Appendix 8. So Appendix 8 works through current post titles, current grades, post numbers, post job title, proposed title, post grade, and the selection method. As the grades there are within the Chief Officer grading structure, the current Chief Officer grading structure is included for understanding at Appendix 7. Appendix 9 then outlines the rationale for a slotting at the higher grade. That's on the basis of additional or higher level responsibilities. The structure as proposed refers to one closed redundancy ahead of housing, and the costs and issues associated with that are part of Appendix 10. So I think it's useful to stop there and pause there in terms of the outline of the structure.
Okay, well, we now want to be open for debate and questions. I think the first member,
actually, I don't think there is a bigger priority for the council over the next few years, and we aim to watch GBOX like by continuing to work alongside the partners, encouraging and enabling developers to work with us. So, you'll forgive me, I'm assuming we're not allowed to mention the amount that's in the appendix, let me just check, is that right? So you'll forgive me if I then look at this and say, one of the roles that go is the housing, which is meant to be one of our top priorities, and it will cost, not in terms of, I don't think in terms of what the person gets, some additional pension requirements. It's quite expensive. And I have to say, I think one of the things that the public are quite angry about is when they see some of these changes going on and considerable payments, because at the end of the day, it comes out of council taxpayers' money or taxpayers' money. So, in terms of that, that seems to be somewhat inconsistent. Amendments, again, as part of the detailed briefing that we just had, looking at Appendix 5. I mean, so it's also, well, what happens to housing then? So that's dissipated across what I can tell, three elements of this new structure. And I think there is something about accountability and the public. Again, another thing the public get very angry about is not having a single point of contact that they can go to get issue resolved, and then you get back, well, that's the law department, that's somebody else, that's the law department, that's something. And you start getting bounced around the system somewhat. So again, starting on housing. And then, having a look at this again, and I think it's interesting what you said about the, Chris, about the policy for restructure. That, from what I can see, because again, there are inconsistencies here of the so the managing director of delivery is considered a senior director. The executive director for strategy is the senior director, but the director for business services, which has got digital, which I think could work with Apple, assets and so on, and the commission hub, gets, is on a different grade to the other two, which again seemed a bit odd. So then when we start asking questions about that, it turns out that that role is, and if you look at the people who report it, is broadly consistent with the role that the strategic director for transformation and resources used to do, but has actually been had the transformation element taken off it, because there's now going to be a separate transformation director. Now that, seems a trifle off. I do agree with the need for a transformation project. But we've then suddenly got David Armstrong, who's been put into that role. And then we saw what happens to all that then. Well, we then find that Joe Blott, who at one time had been a strategic director for a number of these things, IT, finance, HR, and so on, and transformation, is no longer in that particular area, but has been moved completely across the other side to manage to become the managing director for delivery. Now, when you then look at that, so back particular officer who at one time was doing the business services on the transformation bit that was actually the parochial, and has been slotted according to this paper into this particular new role. And then when we started talking about other things, we thought, well, you have to do that if there's a 70% match, because we were looking at other roles in the unit that have been increased, the salaries or grading has been increased. And we thought that the same person would be doing that as he's doing it now, but because there's a 70% or a percentage similarity between the other role, that they will get slotted into that because you have to follow it through. So I can understand the matter of that concern, I suppose, though again I think the public are quite angry about people doing the same job and having a significant increase. But then how come we've got this situation where one person's going to move down to that role? There is no, from what I can see, absolutely no match at all with the role that they're currently doing, and have been moved into that role without any open competition about us taking a view about what the right skill sets, what the qualities are, what the qualifications are to fulfill that role. Now, it might well be that, you know, the person that's been identified here would be the right person. That's not being tested for what is a completely new job. And again, as the chief exec mentioned, we're not talking about these services being moved out to the council or in the cabinet came up in my previous about where they're actually going or not, whether they're staying within the council. We're not talking about that happening within a year, 2 years, as the chief executive. We're talking about potentially 3 years. So it strikes me, and I suppose there's a range of questions in there about why this has been done this way, how does that fit with the particular policy? How are we expected to justify a lot of council taxpayers' money being spent on making a position redundant when it's one of the 2020 budgets that is meant to be the most important?
different than the Jeff, but on a slightly similar line, but it's a question. I'm struggling then to see the connect between those people who've got the expertise in the two service areas that I feel most involved in, which is children's service and adult services, the connect between the people with the expertise and the people who are delivering the service. And I just don't get that. Sorry, I'm just looking at this. I don't want to say anything about the director for delivery, but I'm not getting where people who understand those very complicated services absolutely so poor are going to have direct influence over the people who are doing the delivery. And that's a concern for me.
Thank you, Moira. I think it would be useful to hear Eric's response to those reports. I've got some other comments to make in addition to what we've been discussing, but I think there are, I mean, we raised similar issues, and I believe we've got some, I think, convincing answers. So,
it's okay, just the 3 points that I started to around children and adults. The issues around a secure enough framework, an accountability framework through the directors of both of those solutions. And the delivery side of the organisation. What will happen is that there will be an accountability framework and a performance management arrangement put in place, and they will both have to assure themselves that the services are being delivered to the required standard and in the appropriate way, and the delivery is happening in terms of any changes to those services. We've worked that out with the adult side, and that's largely because the adult side are more comfortable with other people delivering their services. It's still to be worked out with children, and we've been quite clear that we've allowed Julie to focus on one thing for the last 3 weeks, which is Ofsted, rather than this. So there's a section in the report that says that we need to do further work around that area with the Director of Children's Services, so that she's assured and we're assured the right mechanisms are in place.
Just to come back slightly, though I accept that adults are a bit further along in terms of being used to dealing with other people delivering their services, but there's still a quality issue, isn't there? And that is, there's a massive area there to keep your eye on, if you don't mind saying. Well, between the quality of service being permission,
but that's not our aspiration. You're not the only one who's mentioned this over period of time in terms of the quality of adult care provision, which is one of the reasons we need to strengthen the Commission's support arrangements so that they do work provided, and providers, they do have responsibility over quality assurance and not just focus on procurement, which is currently where we are. So that is a fair point, and that is accurate, and we are trying to do something about it. In terms of Jesper, and particularly around housing, The operating model means that some of the services that are currently managed in the housing world need to go to the delivery side of the equation. The issue for us is around what people helped Mark Smith with the housing arrangements. And we have some very good people in that function who will work with Mark to support him in that. But we also have a very close relationship with the Housing and Communities Agency, and they will be providing us with financial support and personnel support in delivering our housing strategy. So we're in a slightly different position in terms of how that would pan out. In terms of the process, I'll let Chris talk a little bit about that, because we've just basically devoured whatever the rules are in the HR. Accountability, and I think this is one of the key points that you made in terms of what Moira is saying, is absolutely critical in this, which is why the accountability framework, not just for children and adults, but elsewhere, is important. And everyone there on the structure shelf will sign by the end of September an accountability statement, which will agree their budget with the targets that they are set to achieve and agree the management arrangement.
student and then to be more commercial, I could reconcile those different figures. I have reservations, well, partly it's because I know some people who have worked with over the years, each of them can be described as working with me. But there's other people I don't know at all, and I take the point of not being able to test them or match them or be familiar with their work, and yet I'm asked here to slot people in effectively. And for the salary suggested, I'd rather go through questioning and testing and challenging them in the nicest possible way, being a critical friend and trying to work out whether the job that they're asked to do is what they might well do or might have some difficulty growing used to, I choose my words carefully. So that is a reservation. The reference has been changed to, and I think as a previous meeting, I said not a form of fashion, and I think there seems to be in threes. Three wheels on the wall and three units here. One particular long-serving officer who we've owned through the education service for many years is to take an area and become very senior over that area. I'm not going to name because I think we know what we mean. We've relied on for many years, effectively, but those of you who enjoy Star Trek might remember that there's an emergency hologram that gets summoned up for medical emergencies. And it might have, if it feels often that this particular officer is summoned up to deal with emergencies, relied upon to do part of work, to that officer being around, so I think there's an error there. At some point, that very senior person might choose to retire and then find somebody.
Well, a new hologram.
A new hologram. Reservations about this scheme. I'm uneasy about slotting people in who are personally tried and tested. Perhaps it's that I don't spend much time here, which you're very grateful about, but also I can't put hand on heart and say this is the right person for that job. So, finally, we come to the issue of the costs of redundancy for a particular officer. I made my view on these things clear last year as to what public reaction is to when people leave and then becomes hundreds of years assistance to implement pension contributions. I'm going to prove that system. I'm sure it's enshrined in policy somewhere. But for the way
Phil, can I suggest yes.
Drifting on to something I've driven. Thank you for the correction. So I'll be careful what I'm trying to say, but I'm uneasy about a certain suggestion that's contained within the papers, and that's enough to make me want to vote against the proposals as a package.
Yeah, well, I'm a lot more sanguine than I would like any of my colleagues who's been to this. My start is the external expert who looked at this operating model, the LGO peer review team in the autumn of last year, who run the ruler over this, said it's an appropriate model to meet the challenges that Eric outlined. And I'm also heartened by the fact that there's an overall saving to the revenue budget of £349,000. As a result of this, and obviously given the huge cuts that we're facing from central government, I mean, I think that's a not insignificant saving, which I think will be helpful. But on the practical points, Jeff started off by saying he thought this was an almost elegant solution, and I think he's going to vote against it, which I think is a shame. But I do agree it's an elegant solution. I think having a clarity between strategy and delivery is eminently sensible, I think, with the business support services assisting both those key branches. So I think at a strategic level, I think it's a structure that does make a huge amount of sense given the challenges we're facing around £132 million of savings, the need to be more commercial, the need to make more progress on transformation. I think the accountabilities issue is an important one, and I asked him the questions in my briefing to the the chief executive about making sure that we've got clarity around accountability. I think we have had some reassurances this evening. I think the housing issue is an important one, but and again, I answered the questions, Jeff.